day, afternoon, evening, morning, wherever you're listening from. It is episode 3 of StraussNet Sports Radio. And for the first time ever, we have guests. But here's the thing. We're going to do a little time travel. Today, segment 1, I'm recording with Tim Bradshaw before the conference championship games in football. It is January 27th. So we're going to talk about the divisional round and some of the developments since then as we head towards the conference championships. And we'll get into the Super Bowl and everything in a couple of weeks around Super Bowl Media Day. But in a few days, which will be right around when this episode is actually released, I'll be with Mark Strauss as we talk about the Baseball Hall of Fame. That's going to be Monday, probably the 31st of January. So we're going to talk right now before the conference games. And then when this is posted, it'll kind of be old news. So bear with us on that. But for time's sake, you know, that's the fun of podcasts. You can do stuff whenever you want. So without further ado, here is the future star of Bradshaw's Brackets, Tim Bradshaw.
Hello. It's good to be here. This is a new experience for me, so I'm excited. I can't get enough of sports, so to sit and talk sports with my buddy Aaron and discuss the future events, especially with football, I can't get enough.
So Tim, like me, is a Cardinals fan, and I introduced him to Blues hockey in the best way you can. Just take him to a game, and sure enough, it was a heck of a game against Nashville Predators in 2019. Tim jumped on a team that he had no real idea about. He probably knew more about the Blackhawks at the time because that's who was popular for so many years. But then magically, the few months later after he became a hockey fan, the Blues won the Stanley Cup. So it's probably the best way to indoctrinate him into St. Louis fanship. But he does differ from me in a couple of ways. That he has some Chicago connections. Big Bulls fan, and they're having a heck of a year. And he's a Bears fan. And with that, we're just going to jump right into it. The Bears news happened moments before we started today. The search is over. The Bears have their GM and coach. As we reported last week, well, I didn't report, but as was reported last week, Ryan Poles is now the GM of the Bears. And I heard on the radio that he's not going to be reporting to somebody under ownership. He will report directly to ownership. So he's in control. Tim, we talked about this a little bit at work, how like the Cardinals let their people run the show. Now the Bears might actually have someone that the ownership group is going to allow to run the show. And for those of you who don't know much about Poles, he actually was with the Bears briefly as an undrafted free agent, but did not make the roster. Most notably, he's been with the Kansas City Chiefs. He has been, for the last year or so, the executive director of player personnel. So he knows his stuff. And he was part of the group that put together this juggernaut in Kansas City. Now, Tim did not know this before he walked in the door today. Like I said, it happened pretty quickly. Matt Eberflus from the Indianapolis Colts has been selected. I was telling Tim he's the defensive coordinator for the Colts. And the Bears seem to do this thing where they have offensive, defensive. Lovie Smith, Trestman, Fox, Nagy, Eberflus, defensive. Now, my buddies at ESPN Radio in Peoria wanted to see a more play caller offensive coach, but it's going to depend on who Eberflus hires as a coordinator. Now, Tim didn't know much about him, so I'm going to walk him and you through it. He spent his first part of his coaching career at Toledo, his alma mater, and then ended up at Missouri as a coach. He spent the first 9 years at Toledo, he was an student assistant coach, and then he went to Missouri. He was the head coach. He left the head coaching duties at Missouri to go to the Cleveland Browns and work as a linebacker coach under Mangini and Rob Ryan, eventually went with Rob Ryan to the Cowboys, and stayed with the Cowboys after Rob Ryan was let go. When Josh McDaniels was going to take over as the Colts head coach a few years ago, Eberflus was brought in to be the defensive coordinator. And as we remember, McDaniels decided, no, I want to stay in New England. A lot of people thinking ownership said, no, you're the next coach after Belichick. Although I just read that McDaniels had opportunities to interview with like Jacksonville in a few places this past week. So I wonder if he'll stay in New England or not. Maybe he, like Brady and Garoppolo and all that stuff, thinks, well, Bill Belichick, maybe he's just immortal, and so I'm just going to pack it and go try another head coaching job. Anyway, I digress. He was the Colts. He was kept by their management team. They asked their GM, Chris Ballard, asked if he would stay, even though he'd never met the incoming coach, Frank Reich. And so he did, and we've seen the Colts get probably better than they should be, quicker than they should be. All the complaints about the Colts have been with the offense, not so much the defense. So Eberflus gets to come in. In my opinion, the Bears were really, really good a couple years ago, the unfortunate double doink but division title year, because they got Khalil Mack in the offense. It wasn't Mitch in the defense, I'm sorry. It wasn't Mitch Trubisky in the offense that led them. It was that defense. So thoughts there, Tim?
Well, I was sitting 40-yard line, 12th row for the double doink game. So let's not rehash those ugly feelings. I'm excited about Pace. He was part of a Kansas City team, and we
Poles.
See, there we go. I'm new to this. Poles is incredible. I love the hire. I think he's the fact that he is part of an obvious winning current franchise is incredible. I honestly don't know a lot about Eberflus, but the fact that Indianapolis was respectable, they did have a great defense. I think that currently the Bears offense needs some help, and they need some weapons. And they have a very good defense in place. So the fact that he is a defensive-minded coach with what they have to work with now, I think is great, as long as they then can build around Mr. Fields. It's one of those situations where, as a Bears fan, I'm going to admit I'm excited about the hires. But I've been excited about the hires. I've been excited about all kinds of different things with the Bears for many, many years. And it just never pans out. So I'm going to tell you right now, I got to see it to believe it.
And I'll agree with you on the Justin Fields side. This team has some defensive pieces. We'll see what happens with Khalil Mack. You have a defensive coach, so I don't think that'll be a problem one way or the other with the personnel. But he's going to need to bring in a good offensive coordinator, and he seems to be a smart guy. And obviously the GM knows that this organization went out and got a guy like Justin Fields. They traded up. I've said it before. When the Patriots got Mac Jones, Fields was the other guy I liked. For a while, I even liked him more. I like what I've seen out of Jones. But either way, you could take either of those guys. I think if the Bears could have either of those guys, it'd say the same thing. You need a coach to nurture that. So we'll see who the offensive coordinator ends up being. And I agree with you on the weapons. I've made the comparisons. Even when Jay Cutler and Mitch Trubisky were with the Bears, you got to have some weapons. Tom Brady's last year in New England, he had Julian Edelman, who wasn't entirely healthy, and that was kind of it. And that's how they fell flat on their face in the playoffs, and he ended up deciding, I'm headed down to Tampa, where I've got Evans and Godwin, and we just saw that crazy comeback, and we'll get into the playoffs and what happened later, but you got to have weapons, you got to have a good coordinator, so we'll see what happens there. We'll touch on another thing that's close to you, or at least your beloved's heart, in that Ben Roethlisberger, while we knew he was going to retire at the end of the season, he'd already said it, officially made that announcement, I believe, yesterday. So Big Ben Roethlisberger, who will go down with Bradshaw as one of the, not this Bradshaw, the other Bradshaw, the famous one. Ben Roethlisberger will go down as one of the greatest Steelers of all time. He went to multiple Super Bowls. He went to two where he won, and the last one he lost to the Packers. He went to Super Bowl 40 and beat in Detroit, and that's when they beat the Seahawks. Then 43, and they had that crazy back and forth against the Arizona Cardinals. That was in Tampa. And then in Dallas at Super Bowl 45, they were beaten by Aaron Rodgers and the Packers. But still, you go three Super Bowls, you're in the playoffs almost every year. And Roethlisberger is an interesting character because as a fantasy football player, I've used him, and he's just not that thrilling. He's a better real-life player than fantasy player. He's got a good arm, but he doesn't throw the ball 100 times. They like to have a good running game. He's had some controversy throughout his career. There were allegations against him, and I'm not going to go completely into that because I'm not here to speak ill of him, but he had some controversy early in his career. It seems like he, as a human being, turned that around. And, you know, just a guy who's going to the Football Hall of Fame.
He's absolutely a first ballot Hall of Famer, in my opinion. Not always the prettiest of quarterbacks. Not someone you're going to automatically just have as your starting QB in your fantasy football lineup. But he got the job done. Hard to bring down. Managed the game well. Absolute winner. He won football games. He won Super Bowls. He means so much to that city. I got to witness my my girlfriend's mother is from Pittsburgh. And so she, of course, is a diehard Steelers fan, and so is my girlfriend. And I got to witness them literally weeping in tears after the game when they lost to Kansas City, knowing that Big Ben's career is over. So there are millions of people who love that man with all of their hearts. And no doubt in my mind, he's a first ballot Hall of Famer.
He's definitely a guy who has playoff consistency. As we look at some of his numbers, the Steelers actually made the playoffs at the beginning of his career pretty much two of every 3 years, and they were in the Super Bowl almost one of every three, and so on and so on. He was pretty much always involved. So as we shift from one playoff icon to the current playoff group, we're going to recap the divisional weekend here. So we had Cincinnati and Tennessee, and a lot of people thought, well, Tennessee is a good team, but they might be the weakest one seed of all time. Now, I didn't think that. If you remember from the previous episode, I thought Tennessee was actually going to the Super Bowl against Green Bay. My bracket's gone, as you can imagine. The one that I listed for all of you in the previous episode is in the garbage can, on fire, burning, and keeping the house warm in this minus something degree weather. So we're going to pull up the Cincinnati and Tennessee game real quick just so we can go through the drives and the scoring plays. But you and I were watching that. You had Tennessee, didn't you?
Absolutely. My original little thought on that game is that Tennessee was just going to walk right through. But then, in my personal opinion, Tannehill happened. And Cincinnati is got my full attention, my full respect now. And Joe Burrow is an absolute beast, doing the same thing in the NFL now that I think he was doing in his college years. And with that defense and those wide receivers and the weapons that they have, I personally think they got a legitimate chance now. But in that game, Tennessee just did not look like the team that I thought would come out to play. They made some decisions that I thought were really questionable. You know, when you try to pass the ball on third and one, when you've got a monster like Derrick Henry behind you, but then you go for it on fourth and one and you give the ball to Henry and you don't make it, well, you kind of set yourself up for that, in my personal opinion. There were some questionable decisions that they made. And I'm sorry, Ryan Tannehill, in my personal opinion, lost that game.
Yeah, Tannehill has been the question mark for the Titans over the last couple of years. He was really good the first year he got there, but I don't think he's a bad quarterback, but they don't have the elite guy to get into a shootout, and that's clearly, to a degree, what was going on. So Tennessee went down early on a field goal and another field goal, both from 38 and then 45 yards. Then Derrick Henry, believe it or not, rushed for a three-yard touchdown, another field goal by Cincinnati, Joe Mixon touchdown, and then the comeback kind of started. That's when they got a field goal and A.J. Brown touchdown, but eventually the Cincinnati Bengals scored the game-winning field goal. And I remember we were both working, so we were seeing bits and pieces of that game, but I remember kind of coming to you saying, oh, it's on, it's happening. And with like a minute or so to go, Tennessee was driving. They were on their side of the 50, and through an interception that pretty much gave Cincinnati their chance to do what they needed to do, and they did it. So everybody's been really impressed with Burrow. They looked really good in the Vegas game in the wild card round. Now they beat Tennessee, who's the number one seed, and I know everyone's thinking they're not the real top team in the AFC, but you got yourselves there. They got themselves there without Henry, but it still didn't translate to anything in the playoffs. And alas, that sometimes that happens. So Cincinnati moves on, kind of the darlings of the playoffs, if you ask me, and they will play the winner of the Kansas City Buffalo game. Let's continue chronologically. While you and I were slaving away at the old Johnny's, wife, so not used to that at this point.
You're in trouble now.
I know. It's going to be ugly later. And I'm always honest. I always tell her when I mention her on the air, so I'll have to tell her when I didn't mention her properly. Anyway, she was at home. She's a big Packers fan. She and I got a bunch of people together last year for Tampa Brady versus Green Bay, and I had the last laugh. She did fantasy football this year, didn't do too well, and pretty much had to convince herself to get excited about the playoffs. So she got her Green Bay hoodie on, she got a Green Bay knit stocking cap on, and went downstairs to watch the game as I was leaving for work. And later, game starts, Green Bay goes up by 7. It's going to be snowy, it's going to be cold. The 49ers made it to this game on all hell breaking loose in Dallas, and let's be honest, Dallas is really good at screwing that up. So it was like, well, Green Bay's going to run through these guys, even with the bad weather, and especially with a warm weather team at a bad weather team, a cold weather team. That's a big Green Bay advantage. So Green Bay scores, and then eventually in the third quarter, it takes all the way to the third quarter for our next score, Robbie Gould kicks a field goal. Robbie Gould still punishing Green Bay, former Bears kicker, who they should never have let go in the first place. That's who's caused all these problems. You know, that and the coaching decisions. So Mason Crosby kicks a field goal, but what we're missing from the box score here, with just the summary, is I'm pretty sure, and you and I, again, we weren't watching this game all that closely, but I'm pretty sure Mason Crosby missed some kicks in this game. In fact, he did miss a field goal. He did not miss the extra point. I thought he missed an extra point, but he did not. So he missed a field goal, so there's 3 points that you could have had. And it always feels like some early missed field goal is going to come back to bite you. But the biggest part of this game, that was the punting that was the problem. They had a punt blocked late in the game. I actually got home just in time for the end of this. And it looked like the Packers were going to win. So I was coming home. The wife's downstairs. She's probably excited. I'm hoping Tampa wins the next game, the next day, so hopefully we can get people together and enjoy another rematch. And I go downstairs, and it's tied. And I had made a joke later, like, well, I came home, but everything was fine before I showed up, and she's like, yeah, it's your fault. No, there was a blocked punt attempt, and it was run back at the 6-yard line for a 49er touchdown. And then, obviously, the field goal later. So this game kind of, once again, another 49er game got out of hand, and now they get to move on. So the Packers season, they ran the table again. They were the number one team. My dad liked to say that the Cowboys this year played in the weak division. The Packers probably played in a weak division, too. I mean, the Bears were a mess. The Vikings were a mess. The Lions are still the Lions. They set the bar for messes. But the Packers just looked better. They looked like they had it all together and that they could beat another team. I don't think it's quite the same as Dallas where they were overachieving. Rodgers is still Rodgers. Devontae Adams is still Devontae Adams. There's questions about the personnel in Dallas, even though I think they have good personnel. They just don't have all the personnel. But the point being, Green Bay looked like they should go farther than this, and they didn't. And now starts the question of Aaron Rodgers. Rodgers is still a little frustrated when they switched. He was frustrated when they got rid of McCarthy. He kind of liked McCarthy. But they bring in their new coach, LaFleur. And it seems like he gets along with them in terms of schemes. And then they draft Love.
And Rodgers is thinking, hold on, I've been here before. You drafted me to get rid of Favre. You know, and you saw with Brady, they drafted Garoppolo in case they were getting rid of Brady. Now, that didn't end up working out that way, but... So Rodgers has seen this, and he wasn't too pleased. And so he's asking for trades or an extension. He wants to... He didn't necessarily say, just trade me. He wants to know, where am I going to be? Now, many think he's still going to end up being a Packer, but especially after the Jordan Love thing didn't work out this year. Today... Hackett, the offensive coordinator for the Packers, was hired by the Broncos, and they've been talking about getting new quarterbacks several times, so that all of a sudden becomes an option. Rodgers has said that he wants to win and that he would like to see them bring back Devontae Adams, and then they'd bring him back. So we'll just have to see where it goes. But for now, Aaron Rodgers does not successfully get back to the Super Bowl or even to the potential rematch with Tom Brady, which we'll get to next, but... It was just a weird game. It seemed like the Packers were off and running. They scored their 7 points, and then they never really did much else. Tim, what did you see from this game?
Well, looking at the game beforehand, I have to admit I look at things from two different angles. Who do you think's just going to win the game? And then a betting angle, I'll admit. 49ers were getting 5 points. Although I felt... that the Packers could just run away with this one. I also thought 5 points was too much. So I was on the right side of that one with the plus five because I just thought it was too many points in a playoff game. But one of the things that I was worried about is, as an example, Garoppolo had never played in a game that was colder than 41 degrees. 41 degrees was literally the coldest game that Garoppolo had ever played in. So with Aaron Rodgers and that team's experience in Green Bay in cold weather, I thought that that could be a factor where Green Bay could run away with it. And after that first drive, as easily as they marched down the field, I was like, uh-oh, this could get ugly quickly. But San Francisco's defense held strong. I personally thought that Aaron Rodgers was trying to go to Devontae Adams too much. And there were, when I re-looked at the game, because I had taped it and I re-watched it at home, I noticed that there were a lot of times where he was so zoned in on one player that he missed wide open tight ends. There were guys that were wide open that he could have given the ball to, and he just missed it because he was solely focused on one person, Devontae Adams, trying to get the ball to him. So I think there were multiple mistakes that they made. Another fun stat, which it's just unfathomable, but Jimmy Garoppolo is 9-2 in his career when he has never thrown a touchdown pass. And that is literally unbelievable because the Niners did not score an offensive touchdown and won that football game. So once again, you have to give respect to a team that is going to go in there to a hostile environment like Lambeau Field after playing the week before against a team that had all that time to prepare and get the job done. It was actually quite remarkable. And I thought to myself after both of those games on Saturday, how could it get any better? Well, it did.
And that's interesting with Garoppolo because of the Trey Lance discussion. A lot of people thinking, well, this is Garoppolo's swan song. And it may be. If they were to win the Super Bowl, that'd be very interesting moving forward. But maybe he's a good game manager. Maybe he's learned a lot of things from Brady when he played with him. But even going back to the Super Bowl they lost against the Chiefs 2 years ago, he's not seen as this elite passer. I think he gets a lot more negative attention than he should. I think he's a better player than he gets credit for, but it's just interesting. And I also liked how we like to date ourselves by using the word tape, because we don't tape things anymore. But I always say that too. I just think it's funny. So that is the Packers and 49ers. 49ers moving on to the next round. They will play the winner of our next game, the Los Angeles Rams. Boo. What's funny is I don't like the Los Angeles Rams because they kind of spit on St. Louis on the way out of town, but I was never a fan of them. I was a fan of Tom Brady and the Patriots. He's now on the Buccaneers, their opponent. So a fun segue there. I was actually rooting against the Rams for Mr. Brady again, the defending Super Bowl champion. And This is interesting because you have two teams that are different from last year in different ways. The Rams got better. They added Stafford. Now, there's a lot of criticism over, well, Stafford never did anything in Detroit. Is he that much better than Goff? He seems physically more talented than Goff. Goff got himself to the Super Bowl. And Stafford couldn't get out of the first round the 1 year he made it. Meanwhile, Tampa has subtractions. They lost due to injury Chris Godwin. Leonard Fournette may or may not have been at full strength after a hamstring injury a few weeks ago. They made it through the Eagles in round one, but is Fournette at full strength? We don't know. And then they were missing one of their offensive linemen, Wirfs. That's always a problem because you want to give Brady time. And then the antics of Antonio Brown left them without Antonio Brown. So they have Evans and company. I keep saying I think Scotty Miller should get more attention. He reminds me of a Chris Hogan or an Amendola in New England, where maybe he's not a flashy receiver, but, you know, slot receiver. He's very fast, though. I think of it as a possible, like, really good slot receiver, but he's used more in, like, the deep game. So that's the matchup that we saw next, and it did not go anywhere near what we thought it would either. Pretty much every game that you could have watched this weekend, almost every game the whole playoff so far, it has not gone the way you'd intend. And for those of you who also didn't catch, Tim is our sports betting expert for the show. We'll have him on future segments to talk about specifically that and other shows long term as well. But let's get right into LA and Tampa. And LA went up 10-3 in the first quarter and then added on and on and on. It ended up being 27-3. Where have you heard this before, Super Bowl 51? Tom Brady down 28-3, so he's 1 point better. But really, the problem was Tampa defense really was not containing the offense of the Rams. It felt like Tampa was struggling to protect Brady, and their offense was getting moving, but very slowly. But at the same time, were they ever going to be able to stop the Rams? And slowly they did. They put together the comeback. They ended up 27-27. At one point, my father and I were watching this game, and I said to him that in Super Bowl 51, they got to a point where they got a fumble recovery off of Matt Ryan, and they needed some sort of recovery, and Ndamukong Suh got a forced fumble, and they got the ball back for the last drive. That was huge. We were kind of tracking the game where we were tracking Super Bowl 51. Like, okay, timeline-wise, there was one point where there were back-to-back fumbles. The Buccaneers fumbled, and the Rams had like a blocked punt or a fumble or something, and then it was just, it kind of got crazy. It was like, this was huge, because it looked like the game was going to turn right back around. And so the Buccaneers end up scoring on a 4th-and-1. Leonard Fournette rushes to the right, and it looked like they're just trying to get the yard, but he ends up going in. He leaves 46 seconds on the clock. 46 seconds left. And you're thinking, okay, if Tampa can just hold him for a couple of seconds, they'll get this thing to overtime. And Tampa allowed Cooper Kupp to take two streak plays pretty much up the middle and set up a 30-yard chip shot for Matt Gay with 4 seconds left to win the game. So the comeback happened. Brady and company did it. And then the defense fell apart again. So did you see this game?
I didn't get to see, once again, I'm a hardworking man. And although I would love to just take every weekend off during this time of year and watch every minute of every game, unfortunately, I don't get to do that. Aaron called me an expert on the sports betting side, and I have to admit and have fun with that. That's a loose term, expert, but it's something I love and I enjoy. So I always look at sports from that angle. When I seen the Rams getting +3. At -120, I jumped on that immediately because in my personal opinion going into this game, I thought Tampa Bay was not the Tampa Bay of last year.
Now, real quick, Tim, not to cut you off, but for anyone who's listening who's not familiar with sports betting, explain the – we'll use minus – you said what was the line for Tampa for the Rams?
The Rams were +3.
At
-120.
And that means – if you bet 120, that wins you the $100 or $1.20 to get you a dollar. Whereas if they were plus, you could bet that single dollar or the 100 to get your 120. So the favored team, you always have to bet more to get the dollar. And the underdog, you always can bet less. And if they end up winning. So when you see games that are usually, I almost never see even money. When you see games that are like minus 110, that's almost even money. That's like your kind of standard, all right, this is as low as we're usually going.
Well, and usually with a point spread, when you're getting points or when you're plus three or you're minus three on Tampa Bay side, usually those are set at a minus 110 on either side. It's when you start getting into the money line on the underdog, that's when you look at a plus money line bet. And honestly, the Rams money line was probably the actual value bet over even the points. But when you're looking at a playoff game for me, you know, if I can get some points out of the deal and a team can actually lose the game by one or two and I still put money in my pocket, I'm all for that. You know, so looking at it from that standpoint, I didn't think the Buccaneers, especially with the injuries, the offensive linemen being out of the game and the things that they were dealing with, I just thought the Rams were just a stronger team. And I thought that the Rams were going to do what they were doing, and that was just literally run Tampa Bay over. I just didn't think Tampa Bay had it. And I was correct, but Tampa Bay also has a factor that no one in the NFL has, Tom Brady. So you can never count him out. I'm at work. I'm working hard. It's 20-7-3. It's in the bag. No worries whatsoever. You know, on Easy Street, all of a sudden I look up and it's 27-20. And I'm like, oh, okay. Eh, still no problems whatsoever. Then I look up and it's tied. Now my attention is a little more on the game than my job, as things are getting a little hairy in that situation. Now I know what Tom Brady's capable of, but how you can let the number one player, in my opinion, on the offensive side of the ball run free is beyond me, and how you cannot, in my opinion, make sure that Cooper Kupp cannot get the ball. Period. Any other player on the Rams team, make them throw the ball to them. And the fact that they did not contain him, you know, was disappointing in the sense that Tom Brady, I have all his respect in the world. And although he's never been, you know, a part of my team that I root for, you got to give it to the guy. And for him to go out because his defense couldn't make a stop, you know, is disappointing for him. But of course, I'll admit I'm also somebody who, you know, we're going to have a new Super Bowl champion this year. So whoever wins it this year, I won't be rooting for him next year. And actually, I take that back. Kansas City has won it previously. So I'm somebody who, you know, Tampa Bay won it last year and I was rooting for them to win last year because they hadn't won a Super Bowl in a while. But, you know, I have to admit that once that team wins it the next year, I'm kind of rooting for them to get booted out.
Unless it's the Bears.
Fair enough.
Now, Michael Lombardi had an interesting point. You were kind of getting to this about how do you leave Cooper Kupp open? Michael Lombardi wrote an article. He used to work with the Patriots. And he's now one of the NFL's top writers. And he said, you wonder if Brady thought Belichick would have never let that happen. Now, I like Bruce Arians. I like Belichick. I like how Belichick functions. I like his coaching. I've seen shows that show that he's a lot less of a hard guy than he portrays the media. But I also like Arians. He's fun. I like the no risk it, no biscuit. I like playing Madden and just like, well, I'm throwing this ball all the way down the field and so be it. We're having fun out there. We're going to give it a shot. So I don't have a problem with either style, even though they're a little bit different. Belichick's safer. But he said that in their meetings, their defensive meetings, Tom Brady used to sit in on some of the defensive meetings because he's that involved. He'd come down, he'd sit like front row. At the end of each defensive week meeting, there was one segment that, and Belichick would run this, it was called the Gotta Have It plays. And that was the play that, games on the line, we have to do exactly this. So You know, one of the plays that comes to mind is the Super Bowl 49 goal line stand, the Malcolm Butler play. They probably said, look, if they're going to throw the ball, they absolutely cannot get this ball in. Marshawn Lynch, different story. But anyway, that's speculation on my point. But if you remember in Super Bowl 46, that's the second Eli Manning beats the Patriots episode. There's this famous the play where Mario Manningham catches the ball falling out of bounds, leaves his tiptoes in, and that was like the play of the game. And there's audio later of Belichick saying, make him throw it to Manningham. That's the gotta have it play. They didn't want Cruz to have it. They wanted Manningham to have it. So in this case, you've got to think, Cooper Kupp cannot catch the ball. Odell Beckham Jr. probably shouldn't be catching the ball. They're saying make him throw it to Higbee or one of the other guys or somebody different. But not Cooper Kupp and not Odell Beckham Jr. And instead, they left Cooper Kupp, who it's possibly wins an MVP award. There's people who are saying he's a better receiver than Edelman was as just a pure catch receiver. I've always kind of liked him for fantasy purposes. He had 9 receptions, 183 yards. The long was 70, 11 targets. He had the touchdown. I've got to think that part of that is that 183 is going to be the 60-some yards he got in the last 2 plays, and that set it up. That set up the final field goal. So they didn't have the gotcha play. Belichick would never have let that happen. There was also some miscommunication they said after the game that they didn't know who they were covering or which guy was going deep and which guy was coming up short. So it's an interesting it's interesting. I'm not going to criticize them too much. You know, they got it all right last year. They didn't quite have the weapons they did this year. They had guys hurt, and the Rams were really, really good. But the reality is they had a chance to win this game, and they didn't. So the Los Angeles Rams move on to the conference championship game. They will play the 49ers. And they're actually not very good against them. They've lost against them twice. And a lot of people are thinking that the 49ers could pull this off. The Rams did go to the Super Bowl in 2019, the 2018 season, Super Bowl 53, and lost to the Patriots in a defensive war. And Sean McVay, who I like as a coach, says he's learned a lot of things since then. So we'll see what happens, but the 49ers have kind of had their number, so that'll make for an interesting game. I will be rooting for the 49ers myself just because I don't like the Rams, but I think the Rams figure it out. But we haven't quite gotten to the championship weekend prediction segment. We have a game left, and that would be the game of all games this weekend. One that people were saying might be one of the, if not the greatest game of all time. I don't know if that's true, but it definitely was one that you want to watch over and over. And that would be the upstart Buffalo Bills versus the two-time defending AFC champion Kansas City Chiefs, who won the Super Bowl 2 years ago against the 49ers. Now, let's set the stage for you. Go back to Super Bowl 53. We've got a lot of ties all the way back to 2018 season. The Chiefs play the Patriots in the AFC game at Arrowhead. Mahomes is up and coming. People think he's the next Brady. There's people writing stories that this is where the torch is passed from Brady to Mahomes, if Mahomes can beat him. But the Patriots stage another comeback in the last few dying minutes of the game and end up with a Rex Burkhead running touchdown to send the Patriots to Super Bowl 53, where they beat the Rams. The following season, Patrick Mahomes leads his Chiefs all the way to a Super Bowl title in Miami against the 49ers. The guy is unbelievable. He plays the game like I don't think I've ever seen it before. He can throw underarm, sidearm. He made a play last year in the Super Bowl, like as he was diving, throwing sidearm. It's crazy. He just, you tune in to watch him. You know, I follow Brady, but it's one of those. He's one of those guys that you just, I gotta watch this guy. I might not be a Chiefs fan per se, but I watch almost all their games because I love watching Mahomes.
Well, and that's exactly why I took the Chiefs on the money line. I had so much anticipation for this game. That game is actually going to stay on my DVR. because in April, when all the baseball games I want to watch are getting rained out, and I might have a night off from work, and college basketball is kind of winding down, it's completely done, actually, by April. That's a game that I'm going to pull up and just watch again for the sake of entertainment, because, wow. I was literally on the edge of my seat, screaming at the TV. This was the game that I, thankfully, I got to watch every minute. I walked in the door from work at kickoff, and I got to sit and crack open a beer and actually enjoy some football every minute of every play of that game. Overall, I personally think, I mean, you've got some football weekends in the playoffs where you have some incredible games, games that'll go down in history as some of the best games you'll ever see. But have we ever had four games like that in one weekend where arguably, maybe, I know somebody's going to come in with an argument, but that's good. That's part of the debate when it comes to things like this and part of the fun. But could it have been the best NFL weekend in history when you have all four games coming down to the wire like that? Arguably just absolutely incredible football. I was on the Kansas City money line while most everyone was taking Buffalo with the points. Now, I understand the weekend before what Buffalo did and how they looked against the Patriots, but I waited because I wanted to get a cheaper price because everyone was taking Buffalo. Sit back, let that price go down even more, get better value on Kansas City because, in my personal opinion, I'm taking Mahomes at home. To segue right back to what Aaron was saying about him. You know, that was one of those games that you could watch over and over again. And actually that game paid off very nicely for me because especially when you get to sit in front of the couch, then you have your live betting app. And I jumped on the Buffalo Bills +8.5. Live in game, and I jumped on the over 51.5 live in game. So that was a very, very nice evening for me. Incredible football, some extra spending money in my pocket, and what can you say? Wow.
Now, on the other side of that coin, we had the Buffalo Bills, as you mentioned. A lot of people were on the Buffalo Bills. The Bills were on the Buffalo Bills. Now, they won the AFC wildcard game against the New England Patriots. Patriots beat them in a crazy weather game in Buffalo earlier this year. Then Buffalo beats New England in New England as the Patriots look to try to maybe make a run at the division, but they kind of ran out of steam. It looked like they might be better, you know, next year, but Buffalo kind of crowned themselves a Super Bowl favorite heading into the season. And a lot of prognosticators thought, yeah, the Buffalo Bills, they're up and coming. Now, I mentioned this in the previous show, in the playoff preview show. Last year, the Buffalo Bills lost in the AFC title game to the Kansas City Chiefs at the Kansas City Chiefs, 38-24. And the Bills were all disappointed that, you know, they didn't finish the job, but it's still Kansas City. And so they kind of set out this year to get revenge. So this was revenge game. And they thought, we're one of the best. We were the second best team last year, so let's be the best. Now, I argue that they were the second best team in a conference that wasn't all that strong, and there are some stronger teams this year. You know, Burrow got hurt last year. We also had all the COVID rules and restrictions. Guys, especially in hockey, have even said, all the rules and restrictions and lack of fans, more in some cities, less in others. The Saints didn't have any. The Superdome's usually a big fan hub for where it's too loud. It changes things. So I take last year with a grain of salt. I do think Buffalo was good, but I don't think that they were this juggernaut that they felt they were. I think they were better this year. So they head into this game thinking, this is it. This is revenge for last year. And it starts in their favor. Devin Singletary with a one-yard touchdown rush makes it 7-0. But then Mahomes started doing what he was doing against the Titans a couple years ago in the AFC title game, where he was running all over the place, extending plays. He ran for a touchdown. That tied at 7-7. That was 14-7 Chiefs, then 14-14. Then the Chiefs went up 23-14. Then it was 23-21. And it just went back, forth. And we get to the fourth quarter. And this is where the absolute show of the weekend took place. It starts with a Harrison Butker field goal, 26-21. Then Josh Allen passes to Gabriel Davis, 29-26, Buffalo. Then Mahomes, Tyreek Hill down the middle for 64 yards, 33-29. Then Josh Allen, with 17 seconds left, passes to Gabriel Davis down the middle, 19-yard touchdown, 36-33. 17 seconds left. We just saw the Tampa game earlier in the afternoon where the Rams beat Tampa because Tampa scored, but they left 40-some seconds on the clock. And that was enough for Matt Stafford and Cooper Kupp to get it done. But you think 17 seconds, that's probably it. So we're watching the game. I'm at my house. Well, I'm not at my home, but I'm at my dad's house. My dad and I are watching this going, wow. I thought with the minute 13 left that Mahomes threw the touchdown to make it 33-29. Maybe the Chiefs can hold on. But then the Bills just ran right through him. Like, man, Josh Allen's gotten better. He was excited on the sideline. My dad even said, don't get excited too yet. There's still 17 seconds left. Too much time. So I'm watching and I'm going, they have a chance, but it's going to have to be something crazy. But I don't know. I'm starting to give up and think, oh, Buffalo's going to win this. Before we get to the finale, what did Tim Bradshaw witness?
Well, and when I say too much time, that was my thought when Kansas City scored.
The minute 13?
Too much time on the clock for Buffalo. They gave them way too much time with that offense. Defenses are just gassed in this game. Gabriel Davis's agent, that man was dancing after that football game because, wow, what a game Gabriel Davis had. Everybody knows who he is now. That man's agent is very, very, very happy. But I thought there was...
Real quick, not to cut you off, but you mentioned Gabriel Davis. Let's look at those stats for a second. Just real quick, because we haven't touched off the finale of the game. So on a team that has Stephon Diggs, Emmanuel Sanders, Cole Beasley, Devin Singletary, the running back can even catch the ball some. Beasley had 6 receptions, Singletary had 4, Sanders had 1, Knox had 2, Stephon Diggs had 3, and those were for Emmanuel Sanders led the group with a long of, I'm sorry, Cole Beasley had a 24-yard, but it was 60 yards was Beasley was the most yards. Then you get to Davis. He had 8 receptions, 201 yards, 4 touchdowns on 10 targets. Like you said, all of a sudden, we know who that is. But I digress. So the minute 13 left. You said too much time.
Too much time for left on the clock. And I thought that the Bills had run the clock down enough. And when they scored that touchdown, and Gabriel Davis literally just juked that dude out of his shoes, and we'll get to my opinion of the Kansas City secondary when we start talking about the games that are upcoming. But... Gabriel Davis just left that dude right on his hind end on the field. They score that touchdown, wide open touchdown, 13 seconds left. You're thinking to yourself instantly, game over. I thought, game over. Buffalo's going to win. They slayed the dragon. But the weapons on Kansas City, Patrick Mahomes, and the difference is, as an example, you've got the Dallas Cowboys who had 14 seconds left and couldn't even move the ball at all. They didn't have any timeouts. Kansas City had 2 timeouts. Tip of the cap to who? Maybe the coach. Clock management. So, once again, Patrick Mahomes does his thing. Tyreek Hill, weapons. Unbelievable, in my opinion, that they got into field goal range and kick that field goal, and then this is a whole nother segment for another day, but then you have the argument of, in my opinion, my thought process, we're going into overtime. Whoever wins the toss is going to win this football game, and you know, my money was on Kansas City. So I was very happy with who won the toss.
So with 13 seconds left, Buffalo kicks off. Now, my dad and I had all sorts of conversations after this game, but we both kind of had the same thought during the game. Do you kick it as a touchback? There's 13 seconds left. If the guy gets the ball, yeah, it's Tyreek Hill as their return man. So, yeah, he's one of the most dangerous guys. But it's 13 seconds. If he doesn't score a return touchdown, this game's over. You've got a few plays left. Maybe one of those lateral things or a Hail Mary attempt, but the game's pretty much over. They kicked it off for a touchback, and I said that was a mistake at the time. Were you thinking about the kickoff at all?
Yeah, my initial thought was, you know, I was surprised that they didn't kick it to someone to try to get some time off the clock.
But you could kick it to an up man, a blocker.
Absolutely. But as I thought about it more, chances are Kansas City's going to fair catch or take a knee wherever they catch that ball.
That's fair. That's not something I had thought
of. 1 or 2 seconds is going to get taken off the clock. And do you really want to give Patrick Mahomes the ball at the 35? So I feel there's an argument on either side. So because I don't really know if enough time would have been taken off the clock, and you're going to give them better field position to where the same result could have easily, in my opinion, happened no matter what. Because when it comes down to it, if your defense makes a stop, just one in that situation, you're probably moving on to the next round. But they couldn't get the job done.
So with 13 seconds left, Mahomes gets the ball. After so many years of saying, all right, Brady's got the ball and feeling confident, now I'm watching Patrick Mahomes do it and feeling confident. Patrick Mahomes, from the 25, the Kansas City 25, because of the touchback, passes to Tyreek Hill for a 19-yard gain, sets them up at the Kansas City 44. Timeout Kansas City. 8 seconds left. Mahomes passes to Travis Kelce down the middle for 25-yard gain. And they end up at the Buffalo 31. Now, I read, and I didn't see the whole article because it was kind of glancing while I was at work, but one of these two plays, whether this or overtime, I want to say it was this one. Travis Kelce said, I'm not just running the route. I'm going where I can get open. Because he's a smart football player. If you watch him, and I think he told Mahomes, it wasn't like, I'm just going to blatantly ignore this. It wasn't like an arrogance thing. It was, follow me, I'm going to get open, even if it's not my route. And he did, and he got it down, and they took the timeout, and you could see him calling the timeout. And then they had 3 seconds left for a 49-yard field goal by Harrison Butker. And that ties the game. Now, scroll back up, go back to stats. Harrison Butker
had missed some kicks in this game, so
he missed. Tyler Bass didn't kick a field goal at all. He had 4 extra points. Harrison Butker was 3-for-4 on field goals and 3-for-4 on extra points. He missed one of the chip shots, which is why they moved it back so they could make it more interesting a number of years ago. This is how old we're getting. That was only a few years ago, I think, but it's going to boil down to a number of years ago. I need to find the elixir of time and go back and not have to work as much, because don't we all? But anyway, so we have a tie game. 13 seconds gets us a tie game. And it wasn't even chaotic. It was like fair. It was a touchback, pass, field goal, done, surgical. So we go to overtime, and you were hinting at this. For those of you who don't follow the NFL, the overtime procedure used to be whoever gets the ball first and scores first wins. So you could kick a field goal. They changed that after the Brett Favre and Saints overtime before Super Bowl 44. That was the Saints won that because they got the ball and kicked a field goal and it was over. So they changed it to the team that has the ball first can score a touchdown in the game. Or if they kick a field goal, the opposing team gets a chance to score. Now, that means you're going for the touchdown unless it's fourth down. Whereas there would be teams in the old rules who would like, oh, I'm on the 30, I'm just going to kick the field goal and be done with it. So it's better than it was, but it's not college. I also think college is a mess where they put them on like the 20 and let them just shoot out the whole game. I am in favor of the proposal. You know, there's two different proposals. One is play a whole extra quarter or like a short quarter like they do in the NBA and just see what happens. Or both teams get the ball. It's like baseball. And then the team that wins the toss doesn't necessarily have to go, well, we want the ball. Like maybe you don't want the ball so that you get that second and potentially final crack at it.
In my opinion, I realize everyone's just like, the fact that Josh Allen did not get a chance to touch the football in that game is unfair. And although I do agree with the fact that he should have had the opportunity to touch the ball, you also can make the argument, how about his defense goes out there and makes sure that he does have the opportunity to touch the ball. So I think there's an argument on both sides. I kind of agree on both sides. I do think that something needs to be changed in the sense that both teams should have the opportunity to make a score, whether it's field goal or touchdown. I think there should be something in that sense where both teams get the opportunity, because in this game, with those defensive being so gassed and those offensive being so powerful, you just knew that whoever won the coin toss was going to win it. But that being said, Buffalo holds even Kansas City to a field goal. Well, then Josh Allen gets that opportunity. So,
now I'm okay with arguments like it's something that needs to be changed. But I don't like, well, that wasn't fair, and that shouldn't be the game. I don't like the petty arguments. They won based on the rules before them.
Yep.
And I'm not going to get into steroids and stuff, but guys back in baseball at one point were using steroids because the league said, we don't really know what this stuff is, but sure, whatever. So they're going to use it. The Chiefs won this game.
They still have to hit the baseball.
Yeah, the Chiefs won this game. They had to make it down the field. And so that final drive of the game started at the Kansas City 25, another touchback. In this case, that doesn't matter because the time factor isn't there. But yeah, you had a few plays, a four-yard gain on a run, a pass for 5 yards, a Travis Kelce 10-yard gain. It did not seem like the defense stopped them at all. There was no, like, I'm looking through here. We did have some third down. It was third and one at one point. But eventually, and Jerick McKinnon was really good in this game, too. That's another person who we can't forget, with Clyde Edwards-Helaire in this game. But McKinnon, the old Vikings running back, he did pretty well. And so they pretty much just marched all the way down the field. There were some third downs in there, a lot of second downs, but eventually 9-yard pass to Travis Kelce. It was one of those where I don't even remember there being like a third and one. There were no fourths. It's not like with Tampa where they struggled their way down the field and managed to tie that game on a fourth and one where Leonard Fournette got free and ran. This was the Chiefs just one play after another. Boom, 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 boom. Travis Kelce scores in the end zone. They win. So it was the game we all deserved. I was happy for the Chiefs. I know Buffalo probably should have got another chance. If they got another chance, who knows if that game is still going on or not all the way here to Thursday. But we have our conference championship games. So Kansas City, the 2 seed, will host the 4 seed Cincinnati Bengals, both division winners. I know some people who are loyalists to the idea in all sports that enough with the wild cards, fewer wild cards, more division winners. So here's a division winner game. The Rams, the 4 seed and division winner in the NFC, will host the wild card 49ers. So I guess let's stay with the AFC. I usually follow the AFC more, having been a Patriots fan. I'm not used to following the NFC with Brady and Tampa and all that. That's kind of new. I follow the teams, but you're more locked in on the conference and the league that your team's in. We're Cardinals fans. We know a lot about the National League teams. If I start asking you about American League teams, you may not know quite as much about them if you're a casual fan. But let's get into the Kansas City and Cincinnati game. I'm going to pull that up here, and Tim's going to give you his thoughts just based on what he's seen so far.
Well, when once again, my mind always is looking at something from a betting angle. Naturally, when you just look at, you know, who do you think is going to win the game, you know, it's going to be Rams and Kansas City in the Super Bowl. And that's it. Well, not so fast. Because we know at this point in time in a season that there's a reason why they play these games. And I think that your underdogs have a better chance than you might think. It's going back to what I was speaking of. I had mentioned I was going to go back to the Kansas City secondary. They're not good. That's just my honest
opinion. They've had a problem all year.
The Kansas City secondary is not good. And in my personal opinion, the Bengals wide receivers core is possibly better than the Buffalo wide receivers. And you have Joe Burrow also at the helm. And that kid's got some magic in him. And the Bengals are getting 7 points. That line is not moving one way or the other, meaning that they're holding it right there. I personally haven't jumped on anything with that game yet because I think that people are going to automatically, without any thought whatsoever, just take Kansas City minus 7. So I'm hoping to get a 7.5. That's what I'm waiting for. Because as soon as I see 7.5, I'm taking the Bengals at 7.5. I'm comfortable with taking the Bengals at 7, but I want that extra half point if I can get it. If it moves to 6.5, I might have to spend a little extra money to get back to 7, but I'll be willing to do that. And me personally, I sprinkled a little bit of money on the Bengals at plus 800 because that's what their odds are to win the Super Bowl currently. And I think that is an absolutely great value with the way that they've been playing. That defense, I know Kansas City's offense is just looks unstoppable. But I think Cincinnati's defense, the way that they've been playing, might just give Kansas City a little more than they expect. And I think with Kansas City's trouble in the secondary, that Buffalo might just be able to keep up with them. There are people saying that we might see the exact repeat of what we've seen with the Buffalo-Kansas City game in the terms of offense. You know, that I don't necessarily have an opinion on. I actually lean a little bit towards the under because it's getting way up there now, like 54.5, 55 on the over-under on that game. But I think the Bengals might surprise some people.
Now, you were talking about the Chiefs secondary. They are potentially without Tyrann Mathieu, who's one of their big defensive stars. He got a concussion very early. I'm sorry, he was in concussion protocol. I cannot personally confirm that he did or didn't have one, but let's be honest, he probably had some sort of issue. But he has to clear medical protocol to play this week. Andy Reid says if everything works out, there's a chance he plays. We don't know. That's as of yesterday. So we're still waiting to see if Mathieu plays. So if they don't have him, that's going to make it tougher on that defense against Burrow.
Huge piece.
Now, you were talking about betting. Everybody can look at different sports books put out different lines. They're usually similar, but Tim has places he looks. I usually ask him what he's seen because I trust the intel that he gets. If you look on Yahoo, I use Yahoo Sports for a lot of my sports stuff. They use MGM, BetMGM as their betting. Currently, they have the Bengals at money line, which means you're taking the Bengals flat out. I want them to win. They're plus 275. So if you bet 100, you get your 100 back and 275 more. Now, the point spread on Yahoo on BetMGM is plus 7.5. So that's what Tim was talking about. And that's at minus 120. So that's decent money to add 7.5 points. So whatever the Bengals score, even if they lose by 3, you win because you add 7.5 points. And that half point's there to separate you from, you know, we were at a Blues game once where he had +1.5 or -1.5. -1.5 on the Blues means they got to win by 2. So if the Blues win by 1, it doesn't cover. So that's just there to push you to that next point. Whereas if it was a straight 1, you can actually have a push on your bet. It means you don't win anything, you don't lose anything. So that half guarantees a win or a loss. So that's currently at minus 120 for that +7.5 points on MGM. And the over-under is at 54.5. Now, on the Kansas City side, they're minus 350 on MGM for Moneyline, just to take them. So, as Tim's saying, the money for Moneyline here, take the Bengals. There's nothing. There's almost nothing to be won for just taking the Chiefs money line. Now you can get the Chiefs at plus 100, minus 7.5. So you think they're going to win by more than a touchdown? You can actually make money on them. Whereas some of the games we were looking at earlier, it was minus money for both. So they don't think that the Chiefs are going to. So this is saying that MGM thinks the Chiefs are going to win, but not by a lot. And if the Bengals win, conversely, it's going to be by a lot. Because they've got, I don't know if I've even ever seen this, where the favored team actually is getting plus money on the point spread, whereas the underdog's getting minus money on the spread. Because I look at this here and there, and they're saying that it's actually going to cost you more to get the spread for the Bengals, and you'll win money to get it for the Chiefs.
Well, in that situation, when they, you know, Vegas knows what they're doing, and when you have something at plus 100, that's an even money bet. So $100 pays you 100.
That's fair.
At minus 120, you got to win bet 120 to win 100. So that right there is, the Kansas City money has come in enough to move that line to 7.5, to where they are basically now saying, we want you to take the Bengals, but you're going to have to pay a little extra for that, because they're trying to even, ultimately what they want is an even money on both sides.
I'm going to say that I feel like I'm going to take Kansas City until they don't. Again, that's not betting. That's me. We got two types of personalities here. I'm the sports pick'em type, and Tim's the betting personality. So I'm taking Kansas City to win the game, but Tim's telling you money's probably on Cincinnati right now.
I mean, I've been wrong a million times. If you want to tell me who do I think is going to win the football game, I think the Chiefs at home are going to win the football game. I just think 7.5 points is quite a bit to give a team that is showing up to play football and has made it this far. It's just a personal opinion. Do I think Kansas City is going to win? Yeah, ultimately, I really do think they're going to win the football game. But I think Cincinnati might give them a game. It might be a closer game than people might think. Now, could I be completely wrong and the final score might end up being 35-7 Kansas City? Absolutely. I've been wrong before. But that's not where I'm going to put my money. And a perfect example is I look at things from a betting aspect on value. That's my key word. I look at everything in life on value, you know. And so, to me, do I think Kansas City is going to win the football game? Yes. But am I going to put $350 on that just to win $100 or $35 to win $10? No, absolutely not. There's no value in that to me when you've got a team like Kansas City, or excuse me, a team like Cincinnati, who can show up and play a solid football game, and I only have to put $120 to win $100 for them to lose it, to where they could lose a football game by as much as 7 points.
So this is probably the game that I'm most excited for this weekend, just because I do like Mahomes. He's fun to watch. And Cincinnati's, like I said, they've been the darlings of the playoffs. This isn't like 49ers who have won a couple of upsets and chaos has ensued in order for them to win. I'm not taking anything away from them, but let's be honest, the ends of those two games were pure insanity and not quite circumstantial. But Cincinnati, who, they won their division, they're a good team, they're up and coming, they won their first playoff game in who knows how long, they're kind of the darlings right now of the playoffs. So I think this will be a fun game. What's funny is my rooting interest as a fan is for Kansas City, but I'm not going to mind if the Bengals win because I appreciate what they've done. But for now, we're taking Kansas City. Is that what I'm saying? Forget betting. We're in pick'em. We're taking Kansas City going to the Super Bowl.
Well, not so fast.
No?
My girlfriend will not want to hear me say this because the last thing as a Steelers fan she wants to see is the Bengals in the Super Bowl. But as I said earlier, I already put a little bit on Cincinnati to win the Super Bowl. And that is from a value point of view, a betting point of view. Do I think ultimately, if you put a gun to my head, I'm going to take Kansas City to win this football game.
That's what I'm saying.
But I will not be rooting for Kansas City to win this football game.
But just for the sake of the bracket that I did a couple weeks ago and just picking them, not betting, we think, forget money, we think Kansas City's probably going to win this game.
Yeah, Mahomes at home.
All right, so we have one side of our bracket. Conversely, the NFC side of the bracket. Now, I said that I was interested in the AFC game, and while the team that I had the most affection for, I'd say at this point, because, you know, my favorite teams are gone, is Kansas City. But on the other side, the team I love to hate is playing a team that I just don't really have any true heartfelt thoughts on in San Francisco. This one's a little more interesting. I have a game that I'm going to enjoy, and then a game where I just really would like to see the Rams lose, but it's not like I'll be, yeah, thanks, 49ers. Like, all right, hopefully the Rams lose this one. But let's get into that. Let's look at San Francisco and the Rams from the fan and betting perspective. From the fan perspective and the news perspective, this was the season, like I said, they traded off Jared Goff for Matt Stafford, who was the we lost every game of the year and got the first round draft pick, the overall pick for the Lions. He was supposed to be the savior, and they made the playoffs once, and they never really built around him. The team just it never put itself together. So the question was, is it the team or is it Stafford? Well, the Rams took the plunge. They traded a guy who they got to the Super Bowl with but isn't flashy in Goff, and the Rams have been really good. They smacked Tampa twice, essentially, even though there was a comeback. They put up a lot of points in both games, and the Rams look good. They look different than they did a couple years ago. Cooper Kupp's better. They looked, coming into the playoffs, like one of the... I said it before. All the division winners in the NFC looked like they could go to the Super Bowl. Every last one of them. I said that in episode 2, that if you come back from the future and tell me, hey, X team is going to the Super Bowl for the NFC, I'd be like, okay, cool, whatever. 49ers, on the other hand, are a team that were in a little bit of chaos earlier in the year. They moved up in the draft to draft Trey Lance, and many thought, well, this is a bigger risk. You should have taken Fields. You should have taken Mac Jones, who eventually went to New England. And they took Lance, and people kind of criticized him for it. It's a good ceiling, but it had a low floor. I'm not as familiar with Lance, but he did get in some games this year. And the talk was, is this the end of Jimmy Garoppolo, who, you know, was highly coveted when he got traded there? This is kind of his swan song. And as Tim mentioned, he's had more success when he doesn't throw the ball. And sometimes that doesn't mean anything. Sometimes there's a good game manager for a quarterback. But it always felt like, you know, San Francisco can do better. They didn't do that well to start the season. Was their coach on the hot seat? Now all of a sudden they are one win from the Super Bowl. And remember, they went to the Super Bowl and were leading and had to be beaten by an insane Mahomes comeback in the Super Bowl 2 years ago. So this shouldn't surprise us. It's just not something we completely expected, especially with the teams that were in their way. So the Battle of California, we see the Rams and hosting the 49ers, and this, I think, will be the first time ever while we saw the home Super Bowl team get to go to the Super Bowl and win. Now we have a new one. If the Rams were to win this, the host city, I actually think it's the first time the host city will host the conference championship and the Super Bowl, regardless of the winners, because it's in SoFi Stadium where the Rams play, and as well the Chargers. So let's look at this game. I think the Rams are going to win this. I hope they don't. I would really like to see San Francisco. We're not getting into betting quite yet. Tim, who do you think, just looking at it, who do you think wins this?
My initial thought on this game, on who's going to win this game, is the LA Rams. You know, there are things, the initial thought automatically was just the Rams. There are some things that have caused me to pause on that thought originally. Some factors that are at play. But, you know, naturally, with the way that they've looked so far, the Rams.
Yeah, it's hard not to take them. It's hard not to say, man, they're, you know, McVay's a good coach, but so is Shanahan. But they've got the quarterback. They got the receivers. Their defense has been just a little bit better. They add Von Miller to go with Donald and Jalen Ramsey. I mean, they don't just have superstar names on the offensive side. They have it on defense, too. And let's be honest, I know that defense is maybe more important than offense in football, but what does the common fan look for? The quarterback, the receivers, the running back. They don't go, who's on defense? Standard fantasy leagues don't even let you play individual defensive players. They have household names on both sides of the ball. Now, as much as I'm drooling over a team that I don't like, the 49ers have gotten the job done. And I like workman-like teams like that, that they just go out there, they get it done. I'm not all that familiar with the 49ers team, but I know that they've played well and they've gotten there. I know Shanahan, and I know what he did in Atlanta with that offense. And
Debo Samuel.
Yeah, absolutely. And now as we shift from the, you know, face value of the game into the betting line, again, MGM has the sports book on Yahoo, so that's who we're looking at right now. We're not looking at any of Tim's sites or, you know, Bet Rivers or any of that. Just on the Bet MGM, 49ers are money line of +145, and the Rams are -175. That's just money line, just to win the game. That's nowhere near as extreme as the AFC game. So they think this is a little closer. Remember, the Rams have trouble with the 49ers. They beat them twice this year. And the spread is 3.5 points. So it's -110 both sides, with a lower spread as opposed to the touchdown. Now we're talking field goal. It's -110 to take 49ers at +3.5 or the Rams at -3.5. And then your over-under is going to be smaller too. It's going to be 45 points. And it's actually -110 for either over that or under it.
There is a time. Now, for me, I have fun with it. There's something to be said about betting where just because a game is happening doesn't mean you should play it. Because sometimes the best thing to do is just not play anything, especially if you're not 100% sure. That's kind of where I'm sitting right now with this game. But that doesn't mean that won't change by game time, because it is the NFL playoffs. And, you know, I'm not another thing about betting, and I want to say this to anybody who might be listening, is money management. The reality of the situation is I do this for fun. This is something that I do with some lunch money or some dinner money sometimes. This is not something I'm going to do that's going to affect my life in any way, shape, or form, and no one should do that. This should be for purely entertainment purposes. I love numbers. I love crunching numbers. I love statistics. I like looking at it and trying to figure out what side to be on. It's fun. It's absolute entertainment, and that's what it's there for, and that's how it should be made. You know, initially when I looked at this game, the Rams were -3. It was at a line of like -125. And when I initially looked at it, my thought was, take the Rams. They're going to destroy San Francisco and absolutely house them. And honestly, what's funny to me is, so, you know, Vegas has the Kansas City line at 7, which I think is actually going to be a closer game. And they have the other line smaller, meaning a closer game, when I think that one could be the opposite. But I pause. There are different aspects on both sides. You have Garoppolo, who's been nursing a hand injury. So you have some injuries on the San Francisco side, which makes you lean the Rams even more. But the plain old nuts and bolts of it is the Rams haven't beaten San Francisco in this situation that often. And so then when you get that 3.5, that extra half a point in a close football game means all the world, all the difference. So I have not done anything with this game myself yet, and I'm going to wait to kind of see what happens. I'm kind of leaning a little more towards the points at the +3.5, with that extra half point being there. And just the fact that San Francisco is winning football games that they're not supposed to win. And when you look at the playoffs and when you're looking at it from a betting aspect, sometimes when you look at something, when I look at something, it's like, okay, you look at the game, Kansas City and LA. And most people bet that way. Most people just look at a game and they're like, okay, this is the team that's going to win. Everybody thinks they're going to win, so this is what I'm going
to
do.
You actually had to teach me about that because.
And that's when I pause. That's when I stop and I'm like, oh, wait a second. So everyone thinks this is going to happen? So I go the other direction because we have seen it time and time again, especially in the NFL playoffs, where the team that isn't supposed to win gets the job done.
You actually had to teach me about that some early on. It took me a while to get it, and then it just finally clicked of the terminology and the pluses and the minuses, and I didn't 100% get that initially, but I did finally, and I used to tell you, like, oh, I think this team's going to win. You had to tell me it's not necessarily about that sometimes. Sometimes, especially with adding points and taking points away, sometimes it's the other way around. And then one of those examples was that Blues game we referenced earlier. We were walking over, and you were looking at the lines for the game. They were playing the Nashville Predators in St. Louis. The Blues had just come off that big winning streak where they got themselves back into playoff contention. And I believe that was in March, actually, of 2019. And you said, why is everyone on Nashville? Well, I said, well, Nashville is probably considered to be better. And you said, yeah, but it feels really strange, like Nashville shouldn't be, it's like almost too much. And you said, the words you said, and there was another game like this too, the Montreal Canadiens were playing that night, and you said the exact same thing about that. And you said, usually when a team's favored in a normal situation, it's by so much. This almost feels like Vegas is pushing people to take this. Like it's, and I use the term, I don't know if you do, but I've heard other people talk about it, referred to it as a trap game.
Yep.
Where they want you to go a certain route, and there's a reason. It's not just, you know, it's not just like this where, oh, the 49ers beat the Rams a lot. No, this is a fairly even-looking line. There's no trap here. It's you're going to make a decision. Well, in those two hockey games, you had, on Nashville's side, Pecorine, who was seen as their number one elite goaltender, and the Montreal Canadiens. These are separate games. The Canadiens were also favored in a separate game. Carey Price, their elite goaltender. Neither of them were playing that night. I went and looked on my hockey side. That was the first thing I thought. I was like, ooh, I wonder who's in net. The backup for Montreal was playing, and he's nowhere near what Carey Price was. And then for the Blues and Nashville game, Jussi Saros was playing. Now, Jussi Saros is now their number one goalie, so he's actually a pretty good goalie. But at the time, and this happens all the time in hockey, guy's a backup goalie, he's viewed as, well, he's the backup. So they were trying to get the extra money on the Predators, but the and remember, Vegas is out there to beat you. They're not out to help you win games. They're out there to beat you. They wanted people to pick Nashville. Well, the Blues are playing their hot goalie, Jordan Binnington, and the Nashville was playing not their number one goalie, regardless of what would happen in the next few months when he would switch roles. And so that's when Tim learned about the whole backup goalie situation. He gave him one more thing to look at. So that's betting for you. It's a little bit different. It's not always, it's not pick 'em. There's a lot of factors in there. We looked at the Cardinals in the St. Louis baseball Cardinals a lot, and I was like, well, they're not favored tonight. And it doesn't look like, you know, they have this pitcher on the mound. I'm not betting against them. But, you know, other people don't have those same rules. But betting is something that you have to get used to. I don't do it a lot. I will talk about what I want to bet. I'll bet in my head and see if I would have been right. One of the first bets I took with Tim was I said, hey, put, you know, like $40 on Tampa to beat Green Bay because Tampa was the underdog. Green Bay was the better team last year, and Tampa was kind of building. And I won that bet. And then I took a horse in the Preakness because I kind of do every year. Like, and it's not always the same place. When I was in college, some friends of mine, we all put like $5 in and drew a horse from a hat. And another year, we all kind of just picked one. And we've done it at work. So I picked a horse for the Preakness, and it didn't work out. I've taken the Red Sox a couple of times. But it's something you get used to. The stage I'm at is I know where I'm comfortable, and I'm not going to, you know, usually it's like, here, Tim, put $20 on this. or, you know, I don't know why I felt so strongly about the 40 with the Tampa Bay Buccaneers for my first bet that I ever placed with Tim, but it worked out.
On that note with it, you know, it's, you know, never mess with anything more than you can lose. I mean, that's just what it's about. It's for fun. Just because there's a game doesn't mean you need to make a bet. Because sometimes the lines are right where they should be, and there is no clear-cut value on either side. You're going to hear me say that word over and over and over again, and that's what I look for when I'm placing any kind of a wager on a sporting event, whether it's hockey, baseball, basketball, or football. I look for value, and a lot of times I am going to go against what most everyone would take. A lot of times, I want to be on the side that Vegas wants. And so, you know, it's fun. It's something I do for entertainment. It's something I'm more than happy to teach people about. But just know that just because there's a game going doesn't mean you need to play it.
Yeah, and that's how I felt about Tampa. I really wanted to take Tampa in one of these last two games, but against the Eagles, there was no value in taking Tampa because they were supposed to do what they did and trounce them. And against the Rams, I felt way too uncomfortable with how the Rams had played to take Tampa. So I didn't. I left it alone. And those other bets I made with like Red Sox and stuff, it's just kind of been, you know, yeah, I had a good night at work. I want to have a little fun with it. It's like my wife likes to go over after trivia and play a couple bucks off the slot machine. It's one of those, I refer to it as pay to play. You know, as a kid, you used to go to Chuck E. Cheese and play the games. You're just spending money. And as an adult, well, I want to put a little bit on, you know, Tampa or Green Bay or the Red Sox, and you're having fun with it. Yeah. I do like what you told me once, you ever want to make a meaningless game interesting as you put a bunch of money on it, and all of a sudden you are rooting interest. But don't do that if you don't have the money. It's just something for fun. Maybe have a fun account. But that's going to wrap up this segment with one Mr. Tim Bradshaw. We're going to get him back for some future segments. I'm so looking forward to baseball season, where myself and Tim are glorious baseball fans. We're looking forward to hopefully having a season. We're going to get into more of that with the other segment. But, Tim, you getting ready for baseball?
Baseball's an addiction. Yes.
Oh, yes.
I can't wait. Absolutely can't wait. There's some other guys that I listen to on podcasts, and they're like weeping because football's over and it's going to end, and it's the worst time for them, when Aaron and I are actually the complete opposite. Don't get me wrong. I love college football. I love the NFL. I love this time of year with the playoffs. I love March Madness. But I absolutely love baseball. There's nothing like it. It's something that it's my addiction.
Dad always says, you know, the Super Bowl ending means it's only a couple of weeks to spring training. Now, with the extra game this year, because they moved the football season an extra week, technically, without the current news, spring training is going to start like right after the Super Bowl. Now, we are in the CBA negotiations. There has been some pickup on that. Dad and I will get into that in the next segment. So hopefully, you know, I actually yesterday, because it's so freaking cold here, pulled out like all my spring training hats and decided which spring training hat do I want to wear today. I'm like getting ready. I'm ready for it. And we'll talk about gear at some point. I'm a huge jersey and gear and sports clothing stuff fan. I'm ready to see maybe some new spring training gear. I enjoyed the logo inside of logo hats, but I'm kind of ready to turn the page on the 2020 and 2021 seasons with all the weirdness with, you know, the COVID shortened season. And it was fun getting back last year, but let's start a new page. But we'll get into that. Thanks for being on today, Tim. We are going to take a bit of a interlude here, and then Mark Strauss will join us. Remember, I told you we're playing time travel. This has been recorded on January 27th. You will hear me again in a few seconds. It will be Monday, January 31st, all things going according to plan. And we're going to talk about David Ortiz getting into the Baseball Hall of Fame, look at some of those results. We'll discuss the steroid era players, the Curt Schilling situation, and maybe look at the CBA. And maybe we'll predict, we'll play a little prediction for the baseball season. I don't know, but hopefully, you know, enjoy the conference championships. Tim and I will be back Super Bowl week to do the Super Betting and Super Bowl Prediction Show, maybe on Media Day. They always have a nice Media Day. But until then, thanks for listening. We'll be back in, for you, just a few moments.